Okay, welcome to the College of Complexes. My name is Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening. Our speaker is Lindson Anderson, known as Andy, of the Northwest Information Service. He is going to be speaking on the topic, Why Americans Believe Things That Aren't True. Let's give a warm round of applause to our speaker for the evening, Andy Anderson.
Good evening. My name is Andy Anderson, and my hobby is translating and transforming large piles of paper, 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 pages of reference material, into a one-page cliff notes that somebody can read in 5 minutes. We call it database translations. So when I give you a translation of a database, that some fact that's been pretty much proven by 2,000 scientists, you need to understand that's not my opinion. I'm not standing up here giving you an unsubstantiated opinion on any one of these subjects that we're talking about tonight. It's going to be a summary. Each one of these that we talk about will be a summary of an enormous database like what exists on tobacco, global warming, nuclear waste. Well, the classic one is the database on the round earth issue versus the flat earth issue. 800 years ago, you could debate whether the earth was flat or round. People didn't have good telescopes. Now, the databases on one side is so huge that we accept it as fact. That's how knowledge moves forward. The paper I just handed out, the core of my talk tonight revolves around this one sheet that is a page out of an article by Francis T. Schur.
Andy, could I have one? Are the extras here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Francis T. Schur wrote an article. It's about 20 chapters, and those of you that want a summary of this, you can have one later. Tonight you can have more printed material worth more than your $3 at tuition tonight. So anybody that wants one of these, they cost about $3 a piece to produce, but they're free to attend these tonight at the end of the talk. This is an article called Why Do Good People Become Silent or Worse on 9/11? And they describe the chart in here. It says anthropologists and rural sociologists have observed that consistently within diverse cultures there can be found groups that vary in their openness to new ideas, groups that fall within a neat bell curve. And this pertains to many different subjects, not just about the evidence on 9/11 that some people don't want to accept. It's about how knowledge spreads through a culture, and that's why it's critical to understand that on many subjects there are 2.5% of people that are called innovators. I call them the early scientists, or like the early Galileo. They produce something. And then 13% of the population are the early adopters, the opinion makers. In this country, that would be a lot of well-paid people in the news media. If they adopt, if they look at the evidence and adopt it, then upon reflection, they change their mindset and adopt the innovation, and then the knowledge spreads in that group. And then about 30% of the population looks at these people who are, you know, accepting the new idea. So they're the early majority. And then you have the late majority, another 34%, that they will switch after listening to the early majority. So you get down to the last 16% on a subject. Those are the people that they refer to as laggards, people that won't change their mind on a subject even after it's been proven to be true. There was a famous military general who was shown a new kind of weapon system, and he said, even if you can prove to me that this is true, I'm still not going to don't believe it. I have a couple of friends. I've known them for years. And every now and then one of them will tell me, there's absolutely no published evidence anywhere that secondhand smoke is harmful to anybody's health, especially kids. And you can, in 5 minutes, you can download 50 pages off of Google, do it from the CDC or the American Cancer Society, about all the hundreds of studies that have been done showing the various illnesses that are documented and the asthma attacks and other things that affect young children. So that's just one subject where lifelong smokers are in the category where they don't accept reality even after it's been proven to be non-debatable. Another group of people were the ones that for years pretended that the Catholic priests didn't have any kind of a problem, that it was all a myth. Well, we know now from watching the movie Spotlight and the others about what Cardinal Law did in Boston, there are studies out showing that roughly 6% of all Catholic priests around the world have been involved in abusing children. But they covered that up for years. So, there's a short. I'm going to try to stick to a basic time script tonight because you can veer off and talk about any one of these blacked out subjects where we published the top 10. There's also a list of the annual top 10 and the top 10 from 1997. The top 10 we published in 1997, people would say, well, there's no way that can be true. That would be on the news. Like, for example, the houses in Schaumburg with no furnace that heat for 10 bucks a month. I've been talking about that for years. And there are still a lot of builders that say it's impossible to build a house that's energy free. And they've been building them out in Schaumburg in the western suburbs since 1979. So what do you say to a contractor? You give them an address, they go look at these houses, they have no furnace, heat for $10 a month, and he says right to your face, well, that can't be true because I have my own business. I'm college educated. That's my truck out there. If this were true, Andy, what you're telling me, I would know about it. So why are you lying to me? This 25-page handout tonight describes the early psychological studies. Back in the 60s, Stanley Milgram did a study called, he produced a book called Obedience to Authority. Some of you may have heard about that. It was a teaching. They had they hired people off the street to participate in a psychological study. And so they had an authority figure in a white coat, the man that ran the lab experiment. And then there was a volunteer who was a teacher sitting at a desk like this, and it had switches on it from 15 to 450 volts, little buttons. And there was another student, a learner, sitting in another chair in another room, strapped into a chair. And the experiment was, help this man or the person, help them learn words, new words in the language. You would give them a word, and if they couldn't spell it or they got it wrong, give them a shock. And so you start out with a 15-volt shock, and then you go on, and if they got some right, they didn't get any shock. So the next time they missed a word, give them another shock. Well, the shocks became increasingly strong, so when they got up to 120 volts, the subject was yelling, I want out of here, this is painful. He's screaming and yelling in the other room. The study showed that two-thirds of all the volunteers they pulled off the street, two-thirds of average Americans, would not get up out of the chair of the learners, the teachers. They would keep pushing the button. They would keep pushing the 450-volt button after the subject was slumped over in his chair and presumed dead. These people had to be debriefed because they felt really bad. They followed the authority figure. They did what they were told to do in the experiment. But they felt bad because they thought they killed this other person. It was a classic study called Obedience to Authority, showing how people will allow their inner ethics, you might say, or their inner feelings to be overridden by authority figures if the conditions are just right. Another famous story they talk about, an experiment, was called the Stanford Prison Experiment, when they pulled a bunch of college men, college-age men off the street. Phillips Zimbardo, I think, was the one that did the experiment. And they had a mock prison set up in the basement of one of the buildings. And so they divided the people up into prisoners and guards. And they were to play the role. Well, the people that played the role of prisoners, they showed all the signs of mostly becoming helpless, depressed, everything else, where the guards very rapidly degenerated into sadistic characters that might be the forerunners of the police that are just gunning down innocent people out here because they have the ability to do it. The experiment had to be cut off early because it was getting totally out of hand. The researcher, Phillips Zimbardo, was totally shocked that ordinary people, given the right circumstances, would go downhill and override basic norms of human decency. So what we have is if information is presented to people in a certain way, they believe the authority. In the media today, there's three classic books that you can get that describe how this system functions in America. One of them might have been listed in the write-up tonight. It's called Merchants of Doubt. Merchants of Doubt. A group of people were hired, scientists were hired by the Tobacco Institute, the tobacco companies. They founded the Tobacco Institute back in the late 50s, early 60s, to pay scientists to study illnesses, to try to figure out some other cause that might be causing illnesses that cigarettes caused, so they could create doubt. And by 1969, there's all kinds of quotes in there saying that our primary product is doubt now, because there's no way to combat the body of fat. We know that cigarettes cause cancer and heart disease and 400,000 deaths a year, statistically at random, in the general population. Cigarettes kill. And so we have to create doubt and say that these deaths might be caused by asbestos or exposure to DDT or all kinds of other stuff. That program of creating doubt was successful all the way up into the 90s. When they had to start settling out of court because they were getting ready to be buried under $50 or $100 billion worth of lawsuits because the evidence was just overwhelming. So the same people that created the doubt for the tobacco industry switched over to taking money from the fossil fuel industry. And they are now, Fred Singer and Fred Seitz and these others, they are responsible for the new movements and the scientists that are publishing articles saying there's doubt on global warming, there's doubt how fast it's happening, we're not quite sure that this is caused. They're creating doubt so that they want to slow down the switch away from fossil fuels, which... There's two classic books that describe what's happening with the trillion-dollar, multi-trillion-dollar industry with burning fossil fuel all over the world. This one is by Professor David Ray Griffin. It's called Unprecedented. Can Civilization Survive the CO2 Crisis? Well, the answer is some civilization would, but 80% of us wouldn't make it if we don't get a World War II mobilization going. If you don't have time to read 20 or 30 books on climate change, you can order this one from Barnes & Noble. It's $9.95, a little book that it summarizes. It's like a summary of 40 or 50 books on the environment. The title is called The Collapse of Western Civilization. It's written by Naomi Oreskes and Eric M. Conway. And they are also the authors of Merchants of Doubt. Same people.
Same people
that wrote Merchants of Doubt have written a little science fiction novel looking back from 300 years in the future. You know, what's science fiction about it is they say in the future they're going to be looking back, sociologists will be studying how it was that scientists had overwhelming evidence that the sea levels were rising, that Manhattan was going to be underwater, that 70% of the world's population would be pushed away from the coastal cities. How is it that with overwhelming evidence in the early 21st century here, they were not able to mobilize governments and world governments to make a difference? China, you know, this is looking back from the Second People's Republic of China in 2093, 300 and some odd years after the Great Collapse. They called it the Great Collapse when the sea level rose 50 feet was in 2089, the year they put. So this is a summary of current scientific knowledge with a story of what things are likely to look like, one pathway into the future, if we don't do something. This article by Frances T. Schur, that's her last name is S-H-U-R-E, Frances, a woman, Frances T. Schur. This was published on Sunday, the 24th of November in 2013. And there was part one of the chapters. She's published 20 chapters so far of this ongoing research project showing there's all kinds of stuff in here about brain chemistry and how people, our brains are hardwired to flat out ignore information, pretend it doesn't exist and you didn't even hear it, if it questions your worldview, or if it's going to be questioning some long-held belief. Carl Sagan was famous for saying that, people don't like to be bamboozled. That was the term he used. He said, the longer you live under a bamboozle, the more you adopt the idea and you find out it's a bamboozle, you don't want to face the reality. The longer you live with the myth and incorporate it into your own daily lifestyle, the harder it is to change. And so then that's basic human nature on a variety of different issues. So her article is not about 9/11. Her article is about how and why people are ignoring the overwhelming evidence that would allow us to move forward as a society and begin to solve the problems. Many different problems in our society stem directly from the myth of 9/11 and the myth of, there's articles right now on the internet talking about the new evidence out of England. They're criticizing Tony Blair. He's being called a war criminal for taking his country into war along with George Bush on a total pack of lies. They're not talking about the myth of 9/11. They're just saying that 9/11 was used to produce another pack of lies, saying that Saddam Hussein and the others were responsible, and yada, 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 and we have this world terrorist fight. The militarization of police all across this country, what's in the news right now about police with SWAT gear, their full body armor, some of them got tanks, bazookas, machine guns. This is all a phenomenon driven directly from September 11th, 2001. Before that, we did not have this ongoing militarization of the police departments and the Department of Homeland Security that's working hand in glove with these police departments all over the country. A lot of policemen are going to work today living under a myth that they're in constant danger of encountering terrorists everywhere. It's a mental conditioning type of thing. And so, what?
Dallas. Hey, wait, Jim.
That's okay. A point of order. If any of you think, if you want to think of something that might be pertinent to exactly what I'm talking about, raise your hand and just say it, and we'll clarify it. That way we can clarify stuff as we go, and it'll be more clear to the audience than if we wait until a half hour later when people have forgotten what we were talking about. Okay? So let's try to make it a coherent understanding for the entire audience. I'm fully on board with that. Don't make a speech or anything, but if you want instant clarification of the point I'm talking about, just raise your hand and I'll clarify. Yes, Charlie,
clarification? There's no militarization of the police.
There's
no terrorist threat. They've just had things in Paris and all three cities and in Dallas.
Yeah.
Those are real incidences of terrorism, violence.
Charlie is, the point he's asking is, what about the incidents of terrorists that are, killing people here and there? Well, the evidence is emerging. A lot of this terrorism has evolved in response to the U.S. military killing people in foreign countries in large numbers. The U.S. military, that's another subject that the press doesn't cover. In fact, that's one of, you'll see it in the literature later, what we call the Golden Triangle. There's three huge radioactive pieces of mythology that you can't talk about in America. And at the top of that pyramid, number one on that list, is the myth, the total myth, that our military is fighting for freedom and justice in foreign countries. The reality known to people all over the world is that the U.S. military, with 800 bases and the operations that are ongoing, drones, radioactive dust dispersal weapons, all kinds of things, the U.S. military is the single largest killing machine on the planet. The number of people killed by so-called terrorists everywhere is 1/100th, 1% of the people that are slaughtered by the U.S. military on an annual basis. This is a foundational myth that people in our country have been living with for 40 years. And Martin Luther King was quoted as saying that any society, where is that quote? It's It's right here.
I guess they're going to use love.
Well, Edmund Burke said, the only thing necessary for evil is for good men to do nothing. We outnumber evil people, those of us that think the killing should stop. We outnumber those by 100-1. But if we don't do anything, if we don't do what's necessary as a society to put a stop to the killing, then it'll keep going on. But, Martin Luther King, 40 years ago, before he died, his quote was, a nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death. It may be argued that we have long since arrived at this point and that the American empire has entered a state of spiritual undeath. We're living in a total state of mythology, and with people believing they're living in a free country, it's much like, I jokingly tell people, if time travel becomes possible in my lifetime, if I live long enough to see it, the first place I'm going is back to find George Orwell and shake his hand. Say, hang in there, George, because our media in the 21st century have exceeded your wildest expectations of thought control. We have people, 2007, Phil Rockstar wrote an article called A Disneyland of Militant Ignorance. Not only are people in America terrifyingly ignorant about certain realities, but they're militant about getting up in the face of anybody that tries to give them a fact that counters that ignorance. And we could solve a lot of problems. Life abuse, child abuse, environmental degradation, the police shootings around the country. If we were able to face early knowledge when something is beginning to get out of hand, look at the root causes and try to look from there. What can we do to solve this problem? It's no coincidence that black shootings and drug dealings and everything else have escalated in the last 20 years as the jobs for low-income people, many African-Americans, many white, tens of millions of jobs for low-income people have disappeared. the factories in their communities just shut down, packed up, and moved overseas. Well, how is a person to support themselves or their family if there's no jobs? People say, well, you're not willing to work for a living wage or work for a non-living wage. An economist wrote that there's 216 million full-time people in America that need a full-time job. Out of the population, it's about 216 million people that need a full-time job, where there's only 106 million full-time jobs in America. Half of this country is struggling with part-time income, piecing together two, three jobs at $8, $9, $10 an hour. And this laughable debate we have about Hillary saying that, you know, she would approve $12 an hour, not $15. It totally misses the point. You know, a $12 an hour is still a slave labor wage for anybody that's trying to support themselves, pay rent in an apartment in any major city. You can't live on $12 an hour. You need help. So the people living on $7, $8 an hour, there are all kinds of welfare programs, social programs, supporting people that are basically the modern equivalent of slave labor in America, and there's tens of millions of them. So all of these issues are driven by the way we don't get valid information on how to solve these problems. I'm in my 21st year of coaching seventh graders for Science Olympiad, and we teach them how to build little cars, boats, robotic projects, and try to get something to work mechanically. We're always teaching our students, in order to solve any problem, you have to first correctly identify the problem and then correctly identify the solution. You can't solve something that's not working if you don't correctly identify the root cause of the problem. And that goes right to the causes, the root causes of many of our critical problems in this country. And right now, one of the most important things that's happened in the last few years was the Citizens United ruling at the Supreme Court. They ruled that billionaires can buy and sell politicians openly. There's no longer any thought of getting caught for spending too much money on a campaign. So Tom Hartman was talking about it on the radio the other day. He said, "What? 200 and some odd, the whole entire side of the Republicans, they all voted in lockstep for one bill that would help destroy the environment. There's not one Republican that stuck their neck out to vote against something that's clearly insane. And the reason for that is, these people have all been told by their rich Republican, rich billionaire donors that if they vote against the wishes of the billionaires will pour money into a primary candidate in the next election cycle. Every 2 years, these Republicans are worried about getting chucked out of office if they oppose any of the insane legislation that's being opposed by their billionaire overlords. Sorry, what was your question, Tim? Do you have your hand up?
I'm not Tim, I'm Don.
I'm sorry, you're okay. John?
No, Don. Don.
Oh, Don. Don. Sorry. Oh. Yes, Don.
Donald. Okay. All right. You said all Republicans. You mean all Republicans in the U.S. Congress?
Most of the Congress, yes. The overwhelming majority of the U.S. Congress.
Okay.
That's what I was talking about.
All the Republicans. Okay.
Virtually all. There might be one or two that are willing to stick their neck out, but on the key issues, they won't lockstep.
Okay. Do you happen to know if John McCain voted for this?
No, I did not look. I only listened to the report that Tom Hartman put out.
Okay.
I didn't look at the actual numbers and count every individual.
Okay.
So John McCain may have abstained.
Okay.
All Tom said was that every Republican, state, they all voted in lockstep. Nobody stuck their neck out to oppose it.
You haven't checked out that.
I haven't personally checked that one out yet.
Okay.
But there's other people that have.
Okay, that's all.
That happens on every vote.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hey, one of the things too that we have to learn is, where are the credible sources of information versus what's not credible? You know, you don't have to you don't have to know a woman personally that was physically assaulted and raped in the Army to be able to understand that that situation is bad. There are credible sources that are reporting the 26,000 assaults a year from women in the military. It's a major problem that military recruiters run a blackout on that one. They do not tell military recruits that one of the top sources of danger they're going to be facing, if they're going in the military as women, they're going to be facing rape and sexual assault throughout their entire career. That's a culture in the U.S. military in all branches that it's a game changer. It's exactly like what happened to Bill Cosby after the women stepped forward and started talking about what he was doing. His reputation and how people viewed him changed drastically in just a few weeks. Bill Cosby, I don't think, could run for president now. I think pretty much everybody's in agreement with that because of the reality of the situation became known to the general public while it was blacked out earlier. What do they have?
Here.
I'd like to, just as a quick aside, let's have a show of hands in the audience. We'll take 2 minutes to, I'm going to read some names of people that are considered innovators, the 2.5% that produce something that would help move society forward. DJ, take this. How many people recognize the name of John Goffman?
Sure.
Show of hands?
Yeah.
One. Helen Caldicott?
Sure.
Yeah.
Helen Caldicott is very well known. How about Nancy Turner Banks? Dr. Nancy Turner Banks. Wrote a summary.
Not one.
Nancy Turner Banks wrote a 2010 book on a total summary of the scientific evidence on the AIDS epidemic. David Ray Griffin, who knows who he is? He's written 10 books on 9/11, and he's written his classic book on climate change. And it's a tremendous summary of 40 or 50 other books and hundreds of articles from all over the world put together in one book. Naomi Klein, people recognize her name, right? Yeah, you don't need to say much there. How about Celia Farber? Celia Farber is a journalist, and she's been reporting things that were totally blacked out by the major media. I see we're getting a College of Complexes banner here, so we'll take 30 seconds for the banner to come.
Let's take their banner.
You just draw that up. Good job.
Okay. For those of you that might have tuned in earlier and didn't see the banner, this is the College of Complexes. The playground for people who think. We were just asking to see what level of audience awareness there is in people that are considered giants in their particular fields. But some of them, like Naomi Klein, she published a book that was widely accepted worldwide, and her knowledge, the knowledge about Naomi Klein is widespread, while the knowledge about Celia Farber, who is every bit the pioneer that Naomi Klein is, her work was totally blacked out of the United States. Published in alternative magazines because she was publishing articles early on about the various pieces of the hoax of the AIDS epidemic. Dr. Kerry Mullis, anybody recognize him? He got the Nobel Prize in 1992 or 3 for publishing the polymerase chain reaction test. The test for low-level viruses, and he was one that blew the whistle. He was a whistleblower on the idea that HIV causes AIDS. He's world famous outside the United States. Christine Maggiore is another one, a journalist. Who knows about Peter Phillips? That name ring a bell? Peter Phillips is one of the founding members of Project Censored out of Sonoma State University. Their book is the number one censored, blacked-out book of all time. It sells thousands and tens of thousands of copies every year out of Barnes & Noble and Amazon and everything else. It's a nationwide bestseller. But nothing in the news about it. I talked to, we have a couple of journalists that attend these meetings, and they consistently claim they've never seen or heard of Project Censored. How is that possible? That's proof positive of coordinated media blackouts on information that would change. If the blackouts weren't coordinated, people would know about it.
Because the book doesn't sell?
Charlie.
It sells hundreds of thousands of copies, Charlie. That's what I'm talking about. It's not that it doesn't sell. It's that the media doesn't promote anything about it because they don't want people to know.
Where's thousands of books.
This book, written by Christina Borgeson. Everybody, does that name ring a bell? Christina Borgeson? She was involved in the investigation of the downed Flight 800 that went down off the coast back in 1996, TWA plane. Remember that? Well, there was evidence that plane was shot down by a missile, a training missile, by accident for the Navy out there, and the Navy wanted to cover it up. So she they investigated, and she got fired and blackballed. And she put together this book called Into the Buzzsaw that describes 18 Pulitzer Prize-winning journalists, their stories. They were all good, long, effective journalists, had high credibility, all of them, until one day they got fired and blackballed for trying to cover a story that they didn't know was radioactive. There are certain stories that are radioactive in America. If you go anywhere near them as journalists, you get fired and blackballed if you don't back off, if you think they should be covered and people should be made aware of them. So anybody that thinks that the press is not running coordinated blackouts on certain subjects, I highly recommend this book, Into the Buzzsaw. The total title is Leading Journalists Expose the Myth of a Free Press. That's the title, Charlie, the myth of a free press in America.
So I hire reporters, they tell me what to print?
Charlie is a classic. We'll address this right now in 30 seconds. There are many journalists who have never, ever experienced any kind of censorship or pressure from above because they aren't trying to report a radioactive story that is suppressed in America. You can go like these 18 people.
That was censored last week.
That's what this book is about. These people all had good careers. They worked on all kinds of stuff. They never encountered censorship or anything else until the one day they did counter censorship on a story that they weren't supposed to be covering. They didn't know it was taboo or radioactive. So that's how censorship works in America. That's why I'm going back to find George Orwell and shake his hand. People keep saying over and over we have a free press in America when we don't. Then there's Joan Jett is another. Who knows who Harvey Wasserman is? One, two, yeah, a couple people. Harvey Wasserman is a longtime environmental writer, writing about the hazards of nuclear power. And Greg Palast, everybody know that he's an investigative reporter?
Yes.
Don does. Greg Palast. Yeah. Greg Palast is currently reporting and investigating the vote suppression all across the country of the votes, the suppression of Bernie votes, and the trashing of votes and everything else. It appears that Bernie won California, and when it became obvious that they won, the media called for Hillary, and they just didn't count the last 2.5 million votes. There would have been 80% Bernie.
Greg Palast has spoken at Green Festival before.
Yeah, Greg Palast is one of the best investigative reporters we have. Bob Petraeus works with him. Well, everybody knows Ralph Nader, Rachel Carson.
Yes.
Karen Silkwood was famous. And Karen Silkwood, who knows Karen Silkwood?
Yes.
Oh, several people. They finally made a movie out of it, right? Because she was killed for trying to talk about the dangers of plutonium leaking out in the environment and all kinds of stuff. Jim Mars, incidentally. For those of you that don't know who Jim Mars is, I would highly recommend this book. It's one of his latest. It's called Our Occulted History. The global elite conceal ancient aliens? Other countries are in the process of opening military files and reading rooms to let people view all kinds of movies, videos, still pictures of all the alien spacecraft and other beings that we have been interacting with for at least the last 60 years since we've had aircraft in the air and since the atomic age. Jim Mars has written investigative books on the Kennedy assassination, Rule by Secrecy, about the rich people that rule our government and around the world. He's one of the most highly credible investigative reporters you can find. Yes, what was your thought?
Andy, you mentioned about evidence. It's one of the favorite subjects.
We'll talk about it later.
Do you believe?
Well, all I mentioned was, Jim, he's written books talking about summarizing the reality that's being reported all over the world. It's his book, Alien Agenda, that came out in 1997, 19 years ago. The introduction said, this is not a book about aliens. We're not going to talk about aliens. Aliens are here. They're all over the place. Get used to them. He said, this is a book about the 60-year government cover-up of the alien system. So our occulted history, we're living under the illusion that the history is what the media and our normal history books have been telling us. When evidence is emerging, the Vatican and the Smithsonian both have archives of artifacts that are found in rock that's 250,000 years old, not 25,000 years old. It appears that the human race has been on Earth vastly longer in modern form than what we've been told. But there's still research going on that. I don't research that subject as much. I just tell you that there's credible evidence emerging. It's one of the emerging things that's not widely reported yet, but
do
it's
you,
interesting.
Do you believe? Do you believe in aliens?
Ask a question later. A question later.
Okay.
We'll talk about that later.
Editors are killing the story.
So.
About aliens.
The editors have killed stories about aliens up until recently, where it's hard to kill a story when people send in all kinds of videotape and video images taken with cell phones. A few years ago, the Vatican put out a statement saying it's all right for devout Catholics to accept the fact that God created other races, because they said, we can no longer tell you you're seeing swamp gas because you're filming the little people walking around with your cell phone cameras up close and personal. The technology for people carrying portable good portable cameras, the technology is so portable and cheap now that authorities are put in the position of saying, who are you going to believe, me or your lying eyes, when people are filming this stuff? So it's the same kind of what we call moving up the Galileo curve. Galileo was first. He got arrested for publishing the theory that the Earth revolves around the sun, but people came along behind him with telescopes. Today it's no longer controversial to say that we have a moon out there, 240,000 miles away, revolving around the Earth. But back then, it was highly controversial. So, Buckminster Fuller, in 1984, he published a book called Critical Path. And he said, every 5 years, the human race gets as much change, we experience as much technological progress and change as during the previous 50. And the change, the rate is accelerating. It's going up exponentially year by year. So unless we have some way to cope and come to grips and cope with this rapid change, society is going to consider approach problems that will push us toward breakdown. He said there's two pathways into the future. Albert Einstein said it. The human race is in a race between education and extinction, and I'm not sure who's winning. So, for the last 5-6 minutes or so, I'm going to briefly list the databases where you can get references, and it's in this handout. It's 18 pages. One of them is 25 pages that talks about the brain research and everything else we've been talking about how people hang on to beliefs that have no basis in reality long after the reality has been documented, published in hundreds of different sources. Like the people that believe the Earth is flat, or the people that believe we have totally honest elections in America. Some people believe that none of our politicians could be as crude or crass as to lie to us about anything.
Oh.
I like that one. I mean, some people say, well, Andy, if what you're telling me is true, that would presuppose some of our politicians have been lying to us. Well, hello, this is what we've got. We're living in it right now. We're living in an election year. Captain Kirk used to say, our five-year mission is to go where no man has gone before. That's where we are. We're no people alive today in America have ever seen an election cycle like this presidential election cycle, where the major media, who was supposed to be reporting the news, are flat out lying and reporting wrong vote totals and suppressing evidence on one candidate winning while promoting false evidence that the other candidate is winning. No, we've never seen anything like this. We've seen dirty tricks before from the various parties to get one person elected here and there, but nobody alive has ever seen anything like what the major media is doing to force feed us one candidate that is the most unpopular Democrat that's ever been run for a presidential election. We're going to talk about that on September 17th, what people need to know in this election year to make decent choices that will help move America forward rather than maintain the status quo. All those years I thought that Ralph Nader was slightly off when he talked about the Demo Republican Party, one corporate party with two faces. They give us a corporate Democrat every now and then, they give us a corporate Republican every now and then, but it's basically the same party supported by big money. Well, our current situation is proving that Ralph was absolutely right. And so, like I tell seventh graders, if you're going to solve a problem, you have to correctly identify the problem. We could go a long way. We could go a huge long way to solving a lot of problems in America if we took the money. There's an article in here called $1 trillion Golden Triangle. There's three corner myths. Those three myths alone are responsible for over $1 trillion a year being shoveled into the coffers of super rich people, while that money could be used to fund education, healthcare, better roads, schools. We could transform America into a decent, caring society that provides affordable housing, affordable healthcare, affordable education, like they do in other countries. For those of you that didn't know, Michael Moore's movie talked about this, the movie called Where to Invade Next. How many people have seen that movie? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Did everybody think it was a good movie?
Yeah.
So yeah, we highly recommend that movie if you want to know why Bernie Sanders' candidacy was suppressed by the media, because Michael Moore was talking about good things that are happening in other countries that we could be doing here if we adopted Bernie's platform. As I said, the cornerstone myth that is never talked about in the press is how we have to, the military budget is not up for debate. Congress just doesn't debate it, they just appropriate more money every year. So basically when you add it all up, our military itself is responsible for the expenditure of roughly $1 trillion a year on 800 bases around the world. It's a global dominance project that exists, especially because of the research in 1998 that showed wind power and solar power at that point had become cheaper than foreign oil. They had to come up with a plan to take total global dominance of foreign oil to control other financial markets and everything else. Our global dominance project has really nothing to do with getting energy for America. Wind and solar are now vastly cheaper than any kind of fossil fuel, and they're going up all over the world. We puncture that one myth and teach our young people that we have to provide alternatives for our young people who are going into the military because they have no hope of getting a living wage job anywhere in this country, because the living wage jobs for half of the people in the country are not here. College students are graduating and coming home to live with mom and dad, because the jobs physically aren't in America. They're in factories and companies located on foreign soil. American companies that used to be here. Then, of course, sometime later this year, somebody's going to be talking about the myth of 9/11 and how we were sold a myth. That was a giant real estate fraud. They demolished 7 buildings all in one day. The media filmed the first 2, and they sold it to us as an attack by crazed Muslims. Many scientists have said, if we wanted to take over the oil fields, drill for oil off the coast of Norway, we would have been attacked by 19 crazed Norwegians on 9/11. If we wanted to take the resources of Ireland, say, we would have been attacked by 19 crazed Irishmen. You kill a bunch of your own people in a false flag operation, and you blame it on the country you want to invade. That's the definition of a false flag operation. And Project Censor talked about that from 26 to 2011. The 2011 handbook, incidentally, and the 2011 stories on their website have all this evidence about the false flag operations and the mythology that the media has been creating in America since the assassination of John Kennedy, with the ridiculous story that Lee Harvey Oswald fired all the bullets that killed him. So we had the Kennedy assassination, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, 1973, oil embargo, 1975, they suppressed the knowledge of a hunt for a bomb. In 1983, a man was driving around, flying around the country, teaching business owners that there's no problem with nuclear war as long as every American has his own shovel and can dig his own foxhole. If the media doesn't cover these stories and promote, you know, if they allow the myth to be promoted, that's how it's done.
No.
Lost that Project Censored book somewhere. Project Censored is in its 39th year, I think. They're heading toward the 40th year. But the Project Censored program teaches journalism students how not to get fired and blackballed if you're going to be a journalist. And they teach how the media runs the two-pronged process. You promote the myth on all channels, and you simultaneously black out the people that are providing the alternative information. Like we ran through that list of names. Every one of those people on there are giants, but they are giants in their field. But the ones that were doing acceptable things that the media could cover, they're like Naomi Klein, writing about the environment within safe issues, parameters. She's widely known. Professor Griffin, not so much, because he's calling for a change of our political system. I'm not quite sure why Griffin is blacked out as much more so than Naomi Klein. Maybe it's because she's Canadian. She gets more coverage. The Canadian press and the British press cover her much more, and it just goes viral around the world, so you can't really suppress it. But in any case, there's tremendous websites that have beneficial knowledge of all kinds that will help you, you know, learn what's really going on. And the Project Censored website in the books are loaded with all kinds of information and resources. You know, the third of the Project Censored book every year is resources in the back. Hundreds of other resources all over the place that they get information from that's sent to them. And it's what's called peer review. These aren't political opinions. They're peer-reviewed stories that make a difference. So I think maybe one last thought, and then we'll start with the questions and answers.
Are you all finished,
Andy? Just briefly, in summary, I would say for all of those of you that really want to understand this concept of brain chemistry and how the subconscious mind accepts certain knowledge and pushes other knowledge away because it might be contrary to a particular worldview. That article, this 25-page article that I have printed for you, is one of the most fascinating things I've seen. I wish I had it 7 years ago when I gave my first talks here. invariably people, somebody in the from the audience will say, well, that's just your opinion and that's crazy. Well, it sounds crazy at first if it goes against a worldview you've held for the last 20 years.
Yeah.
That's the problem that people have, and that's what her psychological research, and you know, she summarized the research of, you know, like hundreds of other people. It's not just her opinion. It's the basic knowledge of what's known about the human brain and how we process information. So I would say, for those of you that want a hopeful outlook for the future, log on to a particular website called Want to Know Info. It's called Want to Know Info, and there's their motto is Working for a Brighter Future. And there's about 12 different disciplines on there. One of them is alternate energy that doesn't use fossil fuel. Another one is healthcare. Another one is you know, free videos and information about the myth and the hoax of 9/11. There's all kinds of good beneficial information that can help move society forward as we come to the realization that our present system of unregulated capitalism run by billionaire predators is not working for the majority of people anymore. The middle class in America, 3 years ago it sounded outrageous when you said the middle class is being eliminated. Now, there's all kinds of articles. What was it?
No one left.
No one left?
No one left.
No, what do you mean no one left?
Wait.
No, don't interrupt him. I want to hear what he has to say.
The middle class is gone.
Yeah, he said, the middle, it sounded, America had a thriving middle class at one time. From 45 to 73, coming out of World War II, the middle class was steadily growing. We had millions of good union jobs, and the good union jobs drove the drive for a decent living wage for people that weren't in unions. You get rid of unions, and everybody's wages go down. That's why the billionaires have been attacking unions all over the country. So, the first step is to learn what's real and what isn't. And then once you're comfortable with it yourself, tell a friend. That's how the knowledge spreads. So that's how Bernie's movement is, messages spread from grassroots, from the bottom up. It hasn't been reported, widely reported in the media. And the media certainly isn't reporting half of the total people that are attending and coming out like big rock concerts for Bernie's rallies. They have not been covering that. The American people, if you're not following the internet sites that have been covering Bernie's movement, you wouldn't know how big the movement is. It's huge. And the American people are disgusted with the two-party process right now. The level of, I must have looked at 15 articles in the last 2 weeks and said, America's number one. Our two political parties have handpicked the two most hated candidates they could find to run for president, one out of each party. It's, they're not only the most hated by the other party, they're most hated by the people in their own party. We're in totally uncharted territory, as Captain Kirk used to say, going where no man has gone before. That's the only thing I can describe it. You have to have a sense of humor. But there's sources of information for everybody that wants it. Okay, we'll start the questions and answers.
All right, Well, let's have a big hand for our speaker, Andy Anderson. Okay, let's get into the questions and answers. I see our cameraman, okay. Tim Bolger, has a question. Go ahead, Tim.
I have taken the liberty of taking a look at a lot of the stuff that, you claim to be truth, and some of it is interesting, but yet I can point to the same or other sources that claim completely the opposite and have just as much credible information. Like if we take, for example, the 9/11, I'm still somewhat of a believer in the government view of what happened with 16 terrorists tearing down the building, but I know you think it's more of a government conspiracy and whatever. I'm going to finish, Don.
Yeah, what's the question?
Question is, how do I, how do I discern the truth? I mean, because like I said, I see a lot of the information, but I can see the other side as well.
How do you discern the truth on any one subject, that, or especially 9/11?
Yes, I mean, I'm just asking you.
Okay, I can answer that for you.
Please
do. I can answer that for you. Professor Griffin, who has written 10 books on 9/11, wrote this one, Unprecedented. Professor, he was given a videotape in 2004 by another friend of his, another professor. And his professor friend says, because David hadn't looked at it yet, he says, David, you don't need an open mind to understand this. You need a 30% open mind and a 7th grade education. The hard part, you know, the easy part is understanding the physics and the physical evidence. The hard part is stepping through the psychological barrier that exists, that this woman talks about. There's a psychological barrier. People won't step through the barrier and look at credible evidence and open their mind to the idea that what these scientists collectively may be saying is true. And if you look at the, if you add up the sources, you know, if you add up the total sources, what you're talking, you know, the people that promote the myth of 9/11 versus the people that promote the reality, what really happened on 9/11, the database on the reality now is 10 times bigger than the database on the side of people promoting the myth. And a lot of the people, virtually everybody that promotes something that is promoting the official story of 9/11, what they're talking about has been totally debunked by physicists, chemists, people who have mechanical engineering degrees, architects and engineers, people with relevant expertise in the fields. The total, the database on 9/11 now is so big that what happened is not debatable. That's why she's talking in this 20 chapter thing she's written. She says, I'm not trying to convince anybody of the evidence of 9/11. What we're talking about is the mental workings that prevent people from even looking at the evidence. Once people can look at the honest evidence, like the people that stepped through the barrier and looked at the Catholic priest problem, they said, oh, that's real. We have a responsibility to do something about it. You have to step through the psychological barrier with an open mind.
All right.
That's all I can say.
All right, Charlie, did you have a question?
Yeah. Andy, this past week, I had a media thing. I sent out a press release. We got covered by two of the TV networks, but none of the print media and none of the other networks. Is that clear evidence of censorship, such as the book you're marketing?
No. There's a lot.
This is certainly a good story.
What story did you send out?
The material. I want to know what is the criteria.
What did you send out?
They didn't cover it.
Guys, this is not an argument. I
can't tell you until you tell me what you sent.
The fact it wasn't covered, is that proof of censorship?
I can't address it unless you tell me what subject it was you sent out.
Well,
what did you send out to the
media?
Did
you decide what subjects are worthy of censorship or not?
No, the media decides.
Who in the media?
The owners of the media.
Why did they decide? Some of the guys did and some didn't.
There's a whole bunch of stories that are not considered newsworthy.
Is that?
They're not actively suppressed.
Yeah, yeah.
They're just not considered newsworthy. That's a whole different ballgame. They get sent 1,000 stories and they only got time to print 6 of them with the space. And, you know, they're flooded with a bunch of junk all day long. So depending on whether the editor's having a good day or a bad day, your story might be accepted or sent to the trash. That's not what I'm talking about.
Let's begin again. How do I know a story has been censored?
Send it again. Send it to multiple outlets and see what happens. You know, just because it is rejected one time doesn't mean it's censored. You know, try to get, if it's really, really newsworthy, one of the major sources should pick it up and run with it. But if they don't, then you start asking why. Charlie, have you ever read one of the censored news books?
I just want to know if this my story was censored or not.
Well, what was your story about? That's all I'm asking.
What difference
was it about railroads? Was your story about railroads or about the CTA or what?
You don't seem to have any process.
The core issue, Charlie, is that some stories the media won't cover because of the content of the story. some subjects they won't cover. If your story falls in that, they will censor it time after time.
All right.
If it's not, then it just fell through the cracks.
All right, I have a question,
yes,
Andy.
What's the question?
My question, I wanted to talk about a slightly different subject from railroads. I wanted to talk about aliens. Now, you said that there are aliens among us.
I said Jim Mars said that.
Okay.
I personally have never seen an alien.
Okay.
I would like to see one.
All right.
But
all right.
I would like to introduce myself and have a conversation with him if he spoke English. But I have never seen one.
All
that's
right.
my expertise.
All right. Now I just want a little clarification here. By aliens, do you mean creatures from another planet?
And he's asking. Aliens are intelligent beings, basically.
Intelligent.
Several of the authors claim that some of them look like just like us, and they may be our ancestors from way back.
You're talking about intelligent creatures from another planet.
Well, yeah,
okay.
But that's what they're talking about. This is what Jim Mars, if you want to look into the subject, there's a bunch of books that claim there are intelligent beings among us.
Now,
they're not reptiles or lizards or anything like that. Uh-huh. They're people, just like us. They might be 1% genetically different, but looking at it, you can't tell the difference.
Uh-huh. Charlie, one fool at a time. All right, but look, you still haven't, what I really went to ask you, Andy, is do you believe the Jim Mars' allegations about aliens from outer space being among us here today?
Oh, he said,
do you believe that the aliens are among us?
I've read enough information, yes. And in fact, to answer his question briefly, Ivan Sanderson wrote a book in 1970 called Invisible Residents. And his book was about all the UFO sightings that are seen coming out of the ocean or going back into the water near ocean liners and sailing ships out on the high seas. More than half of all UFO sightings come out of the water or go back in where the water is really deep. And in 1970, our Navy was running a submarine tracking training program to track Soviet subs. And they logged onto this bogey sub. They initially thought it was, an unmanned, a drone, a training sub or something, to test their new sonar equipment in 1970. And what they found was this thing that looked like a submarine could go 150 miles underwater down to 20,000 feet. They tracked this thing back and forth, up and down to depths of 20,000 feet for 4 days at over 150 miles an hour underwater. So since our sonar got good enough to track these things deep down in the ocean, both the Russians and the Americans have been tracking a third body of submarines that obviously aren't ours, and they're not Russian either, and they're vastly superior in technology to anything that humanity has produced. And these things come out of the water and fly off at 3,000 miles an hour. So there's overwhelming evidence that there's activity on the bottom of our ocean. Also, there's overwhelming evidence reported by our own NASA scientists of the hundreds of alien spacecraft parked on the dark side of the moon that NASA has photographs of that they have been withholding from the American people. The Russians and the others are releasing the photographs. There's all kinds of photographic evidence now of alien activity. One race is up there on the moon. The moon is not uninhabited. And our government has known that for a long, long time. Since the space race, anyway.
All right.
I hope that answers your question.
Oh, yes, thank you, Andy.
Next question?
Well, yes, does anybody, yes, sir, go ahead.
Do you think any of these conspiracy theories could be floated by, like, foreign or domestic intelligence agencies, or?
The question was, do I think any of these conspiracy theories, actually, are floated by foreign intelligence agents?
Or also parts of domestic.
Well, what we're calling is conspiracy theory, a lot of the stuff is produced by domestic American agencies. Like the coordinated events, the classic example that we have in recent memory is the real estate fraud, the demolition of all 7 buildings in one day, where the media agreed to set up cameras and film the first 2, and they agreed to run a blackout on all the scientists saying that steel doesn't melt. I mean, without the coordinated effort of the media blacking out thousands of scientists and people with expertise in all the major fields of what we were told about the myth of 9/11, the myth of 9/11 could never have taken hold. you know, the firemen, pilots, you name it. If you want, log on to a group called Patriots Question 9/11, and they'll give you a list of the patriotic groups, the whistleblowers that are risking their lives and careers, hundreds of them in each group. Military officers, for example, ex-CIA people, people in the intelligence agencies, colonels, generals from the services, they knew that 9/11 was a hoax on the night of 9/12. I mean, as soon as it happened, they said, we have to start speaking out. And the media ran a coordinated blackout on all those people. So yeah, some of this stuff gets, I don't think there's foreign agencies that are producing stuff that's shown as a conspiracy theory in America. I haven't seen much evidence for that at all. Okay?
All right, now, Jonathan, did you have a question?
Yeah, you talked a lot about how Project Censored is increasingly popular with people who want a source of news that isn't corporate controlled, has the freedom to say whatever it wants to say and report whatever it wants to report. What used to be real journalism, like Edward R. Murrow type journalism. It seems like when we have these assemblies, whether they're Democracy Spring this year or the College of Complexes or Occupy Wall Street, the public officials are always invited to come to these events and speak, you know, in a free forum with the people, and they always claim to care so much about free exchange of ideas and free exchange of information, but they don't ever show up to these public forums where there's real journalists and real journalism.
Hey, Jonathan, what was your question?
Could you comment on that phenomenon in, quote, the freest country in the world?
Well, yeah, there's a reason that politicians don't want to come to a forum where people can ask them honest questions.
Good.
And the reason is almost self-evident. Yeah. The politicians, the 535 politicians that make up our Senate and Congress, make up what I call the largest group of highly paid manservants and intellectual prostitutes on the planet. And they don't want to have their prostitution pointed out to them, say, how much money did you accept from the fossil industry to vote for that bill that will promote fracking in this wetland that's supposed to be a national, you know, sacrifice, national treasure? None of the politicians, they, with the exception of people like Bernie Sanders, want to be exposed to honest, up-to-date questions from the general public, because they're living in a different world. You know, it would, like I said, Tom Hartman said, it jeopardizes your income. If you vote against one of the main Republican bills, if you're a Republican, they will cut off your income, your campaign donations, the bribe money, in other words. You'll have an instant loss of income there, and then you will be removed from office within the next election cycle. That's what's happening in the Republican Party today.
Just a real quick follow-up. So would you say journalism isn't dead, it's just changing the means of reaching the people?
There's a vibrant, very vibrant matrix of journalism with investigative reporters. Greg Pallas, Harvey Wasserman, Bob Petraeus, a whole bunch of people publishing on Truth Out, Common Dreams, Smirking Chimp, Greg Pallas' site, David Michael Green. There's a bunch of them with news sites on the internet that post the best of the best without telling us about Britney Spears, Kim Kardashian, Lindsay Lohan going back to rehab. I was thrilled to learn that Lindsay just turned 30 years old. The media reported on that. I don't know what I would have done if they didn't cover that last week. Did some of you miss that? Lindsay had a birthday. She's 30 years old now. That's one of the top 10 junk food news stories. There's a whole chapter in here, they call it junk food news. They give you the top 10 junk and why those stories were covered, because you fill the airwaves with junk, there's no time left to tell us. That's one way they censor or undercover other stories. If they just fill the airwaves with 22 minutes of junk and 8 minutes of commercials on the news every night, then there's no time left to tell us what's happening on these other critical issues. Does that make sense?
All right. Now Charlie has his hand up, but before we go to a second round of questions, I want to know: is there anyone who has a question who has not already asked one? Yes, Gene.
Andy, can you name your own U.S. rep that covers the area that you live in, and have you met with that man or woman
or talk to them on the phone, something like that?
Can I name my own rep? No, I honestly can't. This is the first year that I've gotten involved to the point where I might be thinking about meeting with my representative. I have not been involved with my personal representatives. No, I can't say that.
Thank you. All right, Dennis, you had your hand up.
Yeah, Andy, great presentation. The first name that you mentioned was Dr. John Goffman. When I was a high school senior, I heard Dr. Goffman debate a University of Minnesota mechanical engineering professor. Why is John Goffman so important?
John Goffman, he was basically like the Albert Einstein of his field as the co-discoverer of plutonium, and John Goffman is referred to as the father of the whole science of radiation and human health. Helen Caldicott picked it up. You know, she's a little younger than John Goffman. She's still probably near 70 years old. Goffman died a few years ago, but he wrote a book called Radiation and Human Health, a thick book back in the early 80s, I think, that is still a classic. He was the one that went on the campaign trail. Goffman's work, he was a tremendous whistleblower, and they weren't killing whistleblowers back at that time like they are today. So he had to give up his employment with the Atomic Energy Commission when he found out that they were going to plan on building 1,600 nuclear power plants on American soil, and that we would accept one Chernobyl per year as an acceptable price to pay for nuclear power. John Goffman joined with Arthur Tamplin, another scientist, and they began traveling around the country alerting the public. You know, they were, I think, at the start of the early anti-nuclear movement, and they were scientists that had been in the nuclear field since the 1940s with the atomic bomb production program. And so they knew about the history of low-level radiation. John Goffman is the father of the books, the credible books on low-level radiation. Incidentally, he published a fascinating one in, I think it was 1992, before he died. It was called, The Cure, I think The Cure for Breast Cancer. And his whole thesis was that 75% of breast cancer cases are produced by the low-level radiation from the mammograms. And that was a highly revolutionary idea back then. But it's been accepted as they're cutting down the dosage. They're constantly trying to cut back the dosage on dental x-rays and everything else, low-level radiation, because they know it statistically causes cancer.
Okay, Tim, you had a question before Charlie.
Right. I'd like
you... Wait. Does anyone else have a question who has not already asked a question? No? All right. Well, Charlie was the first person to have his hand up, so Charlie, you get the first of round two.
All right. Andy, you mentioned this guy Griffith several times, and the scholar of 10 authoritative books on 9/11. He's the chief of the Architects and Engineers for Truth. However, only 1%, I think, the 85,000 registered architects and professional engineers in the United States are members of his organization.
What's your question?
What criteria, I mean, using that, it doesn't appear to be that he's getting his peers to join his organization or sign on that they agree with him. Is something you agree with them?
Well,
I mean, 1% of the people.
I can address your question. There was an article on Architects and Engineers just a few days ago. Incidentally, Charlie, you asked about David Ray Griffin. Professor Griffin was a professor of theology at the Claremont School of Theology in California. Professor Griffin is not the head of Architects and Engineers. That man's name is Richard Gage. He's an architect.
Okay.
Professor Griffin is highly trained, and his whole life story was studying how people come to believe or disbelieve religious mythology in its various forms all over the world. And so he is eminently qualified to help people understand how people came to believe the sacred myth of 9/11.
All right, let's make it simple. Why did the guy in charge Why has architects and engineers only gotten 1% of the eligible members to confirm that?
I'll answer your question directly. Here's the answer.
Using your graph.
Yes, hold up that graph.
They didn't
and
get
look
1%
at it.
Even.
You can hold up yourself so the camera can see.
I got it. It's in the back. It's in the back.
Here's the answer to Charlie's question. Charlie will let me speak for a minute. Charlie asked why only 1% of thousands and thousands of architects and engineers are calling for a new investigation on 9/11. Well, the small percentage in the group of architects and engineers, say, in one area, they might be 2.5% of that total that might be called innovators. You know, so architects and engineers just had an annual meeting. A year ago, at the annual meeting where they had like 5,000 members or something, 4% voted for a new 9/11 investigation. This year at the annual meeting, 11% of the architects and engineers voted, almost a 300% increase of people that are entering the early adopter phase where they're looking at the evidence, finding it overwhelmingly scientifically solid and credible, so they can be comfortable picking it up and running with it. Once the evidence is scientifically solid and you're comfortable with it, then it's no longer considered a conspiracy. It's just that somebody that calls it a conspiracy is simply not familiar with the evidence.
Follow up, how many years will it take before we achieve full
acceptance of 9/11? How many years do you think it will take? I'll answer that one too. Hundreds of articles are written every year.
This is within the thing of the architects. Now, we started in 2003. We got 13 years. We got 10% now, or 11%.
Well, the architects and engineers,
be a century.
They didn't start in 2003, Charlie. They were late to the party. They waited until the evidence by Griffin and some of the other scientists had been proven to be overwhelming, so that an architect with a good stable reputation could study the evidence without being heavily criticized as being a conspiracy nut. And so the architects and engineers, the numbers are growing by 20-30% a year in their own group. In other words, they're getting bigger, and many different scientists are saying we're close. Roughly 100 million Americans. The surveys show that about a third of Americans now, 100 million adults, want a new investigation on 9/11. They don't believe the original fairy tale. So this is not reported in the media either. But if you take a survey among your friends, especially among college-educated or college people that have gone through college recently, they've been exchanging DVDs and free videos. There's all kinds of free documentary videos all over the internet from young people that are internet savvy that describe this. It's very easy to find the evidence. Write this down. A college student out at the Chicago Sky game last week, a sophomore at Northwestern, she's out there selling raffle tickets. She said, have you seen the movie Zero? I said, no, I never heard of that. She said, well, that's a great, great documentary, an hour and 45 minutes on 9/11. Here's a sophomore in college that told me about a DVD, a free movie on the internet on 9/11, a current one that I had never heard of. And so that's how fast the knowledge is spread. It's called Zero, Z-E-R-O, and you can view it for free on the internet.
All right, we're going to have to stop the questions from Charlie. And
I'm withdrawing my questions so we can get right to rebuttals.
All right, it is now 7:55, so we got to make time for rebuttals. So let's have a warm round of applause for our speaker, Andy Anderson. Okay, Andy, you can sit down now. All right, so we're going to get into the rebuttal period now. First of all, I'd like a show of hands. How many people would like to give a rebuttal speech? Everybody who wants to give a rebuttal speech, raise your hand. Keep them up. Okay, Tim is raising his fist like Tommy Smith and John Carlos. All right. Yeah, power to the people. Okay, it's 1, 2. Keep those hands up, y'all. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And that's 6. I'm going to
Let's see.
5 minutes, Don.
5 minutes each. Okay, okay, everybody. 5 minutes each. So who wants to be the first victim?
I'll go first.
Okay.
I need to
talk. Okay, come on. All right, come on down, Tim.
Well, what do you take this stuff for if you didn't need it?
Andy, you know, I have liked your presentation tonight, but, you know, I can claim the same things that you're saying about the nuclear power industry and how it's misrepresented and misaligned and the myths of it being not safe. You know, and I could go on and on about, you know, just 100 people were killed in basically nuclear power since its inception. I can also go on to say more things like how safe background radiation is and how necessary it is to life and how our present nuclear power things don't really contribute to it. How I can also say that one of the leading gentlemen of the light water reactor called it a Faustian bargain and it was not the way to do nuclear power. I could go on and on and on about my own views and about my own things on it, but as you said, I'd really like to see the data on it. I'd really like to see the truth of the matter. And, you know, I have taken the opportunities and liberties to watch and look at several of the evidence that you presented over time. And, you know, I'm just not seeing what you're seeing in it. I mean, I've seen how the conspiracy theories are and how they make up and, you know, all the stuff. But then I also take a look at the other side of the government's evidence, especially with some well put together books and campaigns. And frankly, I'm just not buying it. I mean, and I know I'm not going against you personally or nothing, because I am really trying to take a good, long, hard look at the evidence. My conclusions are, so far, that 18 people took down the Twin Towers, that there was a building destroyed at, you know, a few hours later, which was World Trade Center thing, but when the other building was only 200 feet away, of course it's going to have trouble. But I don't really want to get into the details of it. You guys all know my views about thorium nuclear power and how I think it's going to be a key element for combating global climate change. I used to be a climate science denier. I've looked at the evidence and started believing that yes, there is a definitive problem with increasing CO2 levels in our atmosphere. Now let's address the secondhand smoke issue. Charlie is, you know, when you face precedents, in a lot of cases, you know, in a lot of ways, looking at the very court case that Charlie has chided, it would say that secondhand smoke doesn't present a problem. But I also look around at a restaurant and how much cleaner the air is. You know, I also have my friends who like going to places because they are now smoke-free. But at the same time, I also would like to see places where people in a bar could smoke, and you just make a choice. I also know, too, that there's always evidence. I mean, you know, like I said, seatbelts save lives in cars, and we're all required to do it now. I see where you're coming from in a lot of this stuff about the Zimbardo experiments and everything else, but I still find some of your views and your evidence somewhat murky at best. And I'm not trying to knock you as a person because I know you're trying your best to in your own way, seek the truth, but, you know, we could argue about this for hours. You know, I happen to see myself that I'm a fundamentalist Christian, believe in God and heaven and hell and Jesus Christ and everything else, and I believe that there's adequate evidence to back up that belief. But I also know, too, that I can't change people's minds unless they're open to the truth and are open to having their minds changed. But I'm just having a lot of trouble swallowing what you're telling me. And I think the main reason is I just don't really see the evidence for it. I have been looking into it, but I just don't see it, you know, and I'm trying to be as honest with you as I can, you know. I listened to Art Bell in the late night aliens thing, and you know, there is extraterrestrial life. It's called angels and demons and whatever, but that's all I got to say. Thank you very much.
He's got 10 seconds to go.
No,
that's fine.
Oh, he did.
All right.
Whatever.
I didn't know
next. No, that's
somebody
fine, Don.
Watching the time?
We got
it.
Yeah,
I was watching
it. He was watching
it. Somebody could wave and tell me when I got 1 minute.
No, no problem.
I've got a sign here. 30 seconds remaining.
You got it?
Thanks a lot, Andy. Much
okay, if you're keeping time, I won't worry about it.
Deference to authority, that's a subject covered in when I went to Industrial Areas Foundation, community organizing. Yeah, generally speaking, boy, I've had that problem myself very, very much. Deference to authority, those above. But the older I get, it seems like the less deference I have to authority. Too many of them, I think, are a bunch of liars. DVD, they're talking about doubt. There's a DVD, I may have the name wrong, but it's Clouds of Doubt, and pretty much covers what Andy said about they hire people to say the right things. This is mainly about the environment on that DVD. A couple books, Lies My Teacher Told Me. I was supposed to teach high school history, and the I was pretty much believed what I read in the high school history books. But if you believe, read Lies My Teacher Told Me by James Lowen, they are celebratory, they're not factual. So that's another, and there's another book, The New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander, talking about the militarization of our police, that they sell these big weapons to our local police. And who do you believe? Well, I asked Andy that question. I've seen my state rep and my state senator and my alderman face to face. I've had a chance to go back, ask them a question, or see if they're going to vote on something, and then follow up with that. So that's a way to verify at least what they're saying, all the way up to U.S. Rep. The two senators, I'll tell you what, I don't have a lot of faith in our two senators. And above that, the President of the United States, no. Now, when final thing, you're looking around this room. Where is the audience, folks? Look at this room. It's not one. This is a smaller room than we had. There's hardly anybody here. Let's think about that. Thank you.
One quick note for everybody. There's two stacks of the printed handouts. You can take away $4 worth of printed material if you want tonight. Anybody that wants one of them. There's two different handouts here on the Blacked Out News and stuff. So just take a copy with you when you go. Thanks.
Right. This is, and then just a quick note that that you don't get two rebuttal speeches, just one only. And that includes our speaker tonight, Andy Anderson. So I'm afraid that your quick interruption, or note as you call it, will be your last until your official rebuttal speech. Okay, go ahead, Dennis.
Was that rude or what?
Hey, my name is Dennis Nelson. First off, my birthday was officially yesterday, Friday, July 8th, so this is my birthday weekend. Coming here is a fantastic way for me to help celebrate, believe me. And I mentioned the George C. Marshall Institute and the rise of the merchants of doubt in my presentation entitled The Reality of Human-Caused Climate Disruption, The Time to Act Is Now, that was given here at the college on November 15, 2014. I know time flies when you're really having fun. Well, Merchants of Doubt was listed as one of my references, but other topics are covered as well in this dynamite, well-researched book. Merchants of Doubt tells stories about a small group of individuals and a few groups discrediting sound science, disseminating disinformation/misinformation, spreading confusion and creating doubt. They attempted to undermine the major scientific consensus on the Strategic Defense Initiative, SDI, otherwise called Star Wars, cigarette smoking and secondhand smoke, acid rain or acidic disposition, ozone depletion in the ozone hole, human-made climate disruption or climate chaos. Both of these are better, I think, than saying global warming and climate change and dangerous chemical pesticides like DDT. The scientific consensus on each of these issues was based upon the organized accumulation and scrutiny of evidence. They attempted to prevent the regulation of tobacco and environmental tobacco smoke, ozone-destroying chlorofluorocarbon CFCs, air pollution from coal-fired power plants and other sources, and toxic chlorinated hydrocarbon pesticides like DDT. While reading this book, two major points crossed my mind. Number one, it is not enough just to be correct. You also have to be persuasive. And number two, a smaller group of people can influence public policy if they are determined enough, connected and powerful enough, vocal enough, and have deep enough pockets. And down through the years, I've worked on every issue covered in The Merchants of Doubt. The use of language, or rather the misuse of language, is a key theme of the book. While Merchants of Doubt is an excellent book, it is not perfect. The book fails to discuss the nuclear industry's massive multi-million dollar campaign to push commercial nuclear reactors, which of course I've been fighting. This started in 1976, intensified after the beginning of Three Mile Island on March 28, 1979, and really took off during the summer of 1988 with the heat wave and drought and climate scientist James Hansen's famous congressional testimony. On page 262, the authors state that nuclear power, quote, may help us out of the global warming conundrum, unquote, an assumption I've rejected umpteen zillion times here at the college, and maybe Andy can talk a little bit more about that in his rebuttal. But they correctly say nuclear power, quote, was a byproduct of the technology that launched the Cold War, the atomic bomb, unquote. I'm going to say a name, Environmental Progress Illinois. Now this sounds like a really neat group that I should be a member of, doesn't it? Environmental Progress Illinois is actually a pro-nuclear front group. It was deliberately contrived in the attempt to undermine the major pro-environmental consensus that nuclear power is a fundamentally flawed energy source, creating its own set of problems and making our own climate crisis even worse. Real Illinois environmental progress would be to deny the Exelon nuclear bailout and pass the Illinois Clean Jobs Bill promoting efficiency and renewables in Springfield and permanently close Exelon's money-losing Clinton and Quad Cities nuclear plants. Well, Merchants of Doubt was published in 2010. And it covers the harassment and intimidation of climate scientists. But the climate science denying and climate action delaying Republicans in Congress are now too busy being the allies to the Merchants of Doubt in the form of ExxonMobil's executives and attorneys. In doing this, they have reached a new low recently in harassment and intimidation. On March 18th of this year, U.S. Representative Lamar Smith, Republican from Texas, chair of the House Committee on Science, Space, and Technology, along with 12 other Republican committee members, sent a letter to 16 state attorneys general and 8 public interest groups, including the Union of Concerned Scientists, 350.org, and the Climate Reality Project. I have a copy of this letter that was sent to Illinois Attorney General Lisa Madigan. The letter demands that they turn over stacks of documents. This is really a piece of claptrap. It goes so far to claim that their inquiries into ExxonMobil's climate deception since the 1970s amounts to a violation of the giant oil corporation's right to free speech under the First Amendment.
Okay,
thank
Dennis,
you.
Thank you very much.
And you don't have to do that, Don, because it's all down pat. Just let me finish, please.
Excuse me.
All right. Don't interrupt again.
All right. It's okay. Does anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech? Okay. All right. Well, we got two contenders.
I'll go first.
Yeah.
I don't want to follow Charlie.
Okay. Charlie is a tough act to follow.
Yes, he is.
Okay, Charlie. Do you want to go first then?
Or what do you want? You're a runner.
I want to
to go before Charlie.
Okay, you're going to go before Charlie.
No, take him, please.
No, no.
No, take him, please, take him.
This, I'm... Oh, this is ridiculous.
Hey, two books that I highly recommend is one by Robert McChesney and John Nichols. It's called People Get Ready. It's just come out. It's about a lot of the things that Andy talked about tonight. It's a great read. Another one is by Noam Chomsky. It's called Who Rules the World? Also a new book. Also a great read. The reason I mentioned this book by Noam Chomsky, he's the world's most cited living author. Now, how many people heard Noam Chomsky on the mainstream airwaves within the last decade? Now, what program was that?
I think C-SPAN.
Well, that's not really mainstream. That's cable, but okay, yeah. fair enough. So he got on once. Okay. So that's the kind of democracy we live in.
All right, thanks.
Thank you. One of the things that we love in America, we love our block parties, we love our family reunions, our picnics, our barbecues, our music fests, our outdoor arts and crafts festivals. We like to assemble. It's a natural part of who we are. It's a natural part of being a human being. It's a natural part of our communities and our DNA. We like to have free exchange of ideas, free exchange of information. We like to find solutions. We like to find answers. We like to talk about our visions for the future, our dreams of how to make it better for future generations. Here's a picture of Tuesday, November 4th, 2008 in Grant Park. Now that's a lot of people. I don't know if anybody can see, everybody can see that. That's just one bridge coming back from the celebration victory for the president in 2008 in Grant Park. That's what politicians listen to. That's what public officials listen to. They listen to large numbers of mass, peaceful, and democratic mobilization. If you think they're going to listen to you on election day because you chose one of their two pre-selected choices of who to continue to hold wealth and power and influence over the most violent, greedy, dishonest, unjust government in the world, okay, you know, you can exercise that self-delusion. That's one of the rights in a democracy. What I would suggest, and what millions of people all over the country are suggesting for system changes to happen, is to stop being sheep and stop being funneled into this electoral solution is the only solution situation. There's lots of things you can do to get mass mobilization through involving yourself and giving your time and energy to local nonprofits and grassroots organizations. Slim Brundage once said, remember, the USA didn't get rid of fascism. We still have it. More than that, we support it. Every day, a bite is taken out of your pay envelope to support it throughout the world. So, I'll just leave it on that. Thank you to the speakers.
All right, let's thank Andy. Thank you very much. Thank you for your handouts and time and effort. Here I'll be eclectic as usual. There we go. We've got to have a little thing here. I'll be eclectic, jumping around a little bit. We have public opinion, a multitude of views that influence the legislation that is enacted by our legislative assemblies, and all sorts of associations. I belong to any number of them, and why do I join them? So that they will influence public opinion, views, and legislation. Some people say guns are dangerous, and some say guns are safe and should not be regulated. To say one story gets more coverage than the other doesn't mean I don't know what your working definition is of censorship. This is a continuing process in our arranged democratic apparatus. So you're trying to influence public opinion. to claim that one side is more successful than the other, therefore there has to be censorship, is not validated by the evidence. You simply can't, on that basis alone, do that. Here's the other thing now. When you work for the media, it's in the real world. It's like the world of work. And I hate to tell you, but there's a thing called managers have rights. And the man, one of the managers, even though I'm a union guy, managers have the right to assign work. And anybody you hear, you work for an editor, if you work in a TV station, a radio station, they have even called it assignment editors. Because they tell you what stories to cover, which ones to go out for, which ones to spend time writing about, which ones do you make videos of, which ones do you do interviews. And you have to answer to them, because they have an editorial policy of the publications, and that's it. And you, now, there are many, many various people who say, I have the story of the century. I used to get with that girl from the Philadelphia Inquirer, and she had this story, oh, my editor, he wouldn't let me do this story. And I wanted to tell her so desperately, I don't know why he let you even bother with it in the first place, because it was terrible. These are decisions. This is the world of work. You can't decide what you want to do on your own. And so the people bellyache. Oh my God, they wouldn't let me do my story. And I didn't get the Pulitzer Prize. Well, how many times I heard that? That's a lot of time. The other thing is, if you think Proof of Aliens is based because some guy's got a video he did with his telephone and put it up on YouTube, that's our criteria of truth. The other thing is, I'm sorry, Jim Mars, I like him. He's the guy from Dallas who writes all about the Kennedy assassination, and he gets into other areas. There's another thing, though, that I really, really, if you listen to his things, you go into things, he's his right-wing anti-government, though. And that's the thing to keep in mind. I like the guy, but I know that he's a Rush Limbaugh type of guy. I'm sorry on that. Now, the thing about censorship, you're going to talk about, they didn't get the votes or something like this. Everybody who loses an election says, or loses something, says what? I was cheated. They rigged the thing against me. Now, there's plenty of stuff in the news. Plenty of things. It's not been censored. But has it been established? Is it a fact? Let me tell you. If you put out press releases, at least the ones that I put out, they call it fact checks. Everything in there is absolutely, totally true. I don't even play with the language. If it hasn't got the truth in it, you want to know why? Because as soon as a reporter or an editor sees that you got doo-wah-diddy or gibberish, zap goes your story. So that's not going to... Now the last thing is, I'll tell you one of the things that should be thing is this email stuff in Hillary. I directly and absolutely spent 10 years on emails used by employees in the government, the federal government. And I want to tell you, talk about one that should be dropped or stupid stories, that's the one right there. Now, why is that story being perpetuated when it should be killed? You talk about all the stories that, let me tell you this, there is no legitimacy. And this was my job. Social media and emails, and I had cases and cases where people's jobs, I wrote the regs, the government. This story has no basis in reality. Why is it still in the news? Stupid nonsense. She is not guilty of anything at all, by any way, shape, or form.
Charlie.
Yeah, all right, I'm going. All right, that's about it. I'd like to talk about that too, that email thing is still... Around.
Why don't you put a talk on her, Charlie? And
really, she is.
Okay, conference talk.
All right.
Is there anybody else who wishes to give a rebuttal speech? Yes, sir. Come on down.
Like in the gulag.
Gulag. Oh, well, not least I'm being compared to the Soviets.
Gulag.
I don't
have gulag to say.
Gulag.
But I have a woman who does my taxes. And I asked her, I said, do you smoke? I said, oh yes, I used to. Oh, what did you smoke?
Kent cigarettes. Oh, that had the micronite filter, didn't it? Yes. Do you know what the micronite filter was? It was asbestos. So I don't know if the cigarettes aren't around anymore. All I can say is, you know, now cigarettes are around, but you know, they're not in here. We don't smoke in here anymore. And women who have babies, they say, don't smoke. So it's slowly getting out, but American manufacturers have found a good place that's called China. I think there's several hundred million Chinese that now smoke. So you can make your money different ways. A lot of it not very good. So I think slowly, I hope we don't become like Easter Island out in the middle of the Pacific, where there's these giant stone statues. The forests are gone, and the people aren't there anymore. Is this what happens to our society at the end?
Maybe.
All right. Okay. All right. Now, is there anybody else who wishes to give a rebuttal speech? Gene?
No, I'm going to the bathroom.
Okay.
You only got 5 minutes.
Sir, did you wish to speak?
Can I just ask Andy a question?
Well.
Very quick question.
Yeah. What is it?
The book merchants, is their point that there are analogies among these different denial operations, or are they actually conducted by the same organizations and individuals?
You mean the ones that are created now?
Yes.
Or the ones that are investigated? No, I mean the ones that created now at tobacco, the people who are paid to say the same. The ones that created the doubt, they shifted over to being paid by the prosecutor. It was the same people.
So it's actually the same
lawyers, scientists that are taking money to say there's no law for the world.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, listen, we need to move things along here. Yes. All right, now, does anybody else... Does anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech? Okay? I would just like to say again that the time for questions and answers... The question and answer session already happened. So does anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech? No? All right, well, I'll give a very brief rebuttal speech. Carl, are you timing me?
Yes, I am.
Okay, Jonathan. All right. First of all, I'd like to thank Andy for coming here and giving this presentation. Now, you know, a lot of people, you know, there are a lot of people who doubt what the government has said about 9/11, and not the least because the government has actually changed its story about 9/11. Right? For example, in the immediate aftermath of 9/11, the Bush administration claimed that Mohammed Atta, the ringleader of the hijackers, had met with an Iraqi government agent in Prague. That story was later refuted. But they used that and some other things as a pretext to try to connect Saddam Hussein, the dictator of Iraq, with 9/11. Now, that was a total lie. When people realized, and the craziest part about it is the media initially reported that story, and they also cited the fact that it had been refuted by the Czech Republic, which is an ally of the U.S. But then 2 years later, that was in 2001, 2 years later, the media reported this meeting with this supposed meeting that never happened with this Iraqi agent. And they reported it as if it was true. So now, 2 years later, even though they'd already reported the truth, the very same media outlets were now reporting as the refuted story as fact. So the media lied to the people. And now, when people realize that their government and the media and the other so-called authority figures have lied to us, well, we stop trusting them. How do we know when they're telling the truth and when they're lying? You know, if people lie to you, you can't trust them anymore. You can't believe them. And when that happens,
we become much more likely to believe alternative theories, alternative explanations for what's really going on, even if these alternative theories are false. We aren't experts on everything. You know, most of us do not have doctoral degrees in electrical engineering, physics, astronomy, biology, and climatology, and everything else you'd have to know to really know what's going on. So normally when we study the media or read anything, we rely on these experts to tell us what's going on. But if the experts, the authorities, cannot be trusted, what are we supposed to believe? And how can we any longer tell the truth from the lies? So this is one of the reasons why you have all these conspiracy theories and why there are so many people who believe them. Just as an example, I mean, I already mentioned, you know, I could mention global warming. The Bush administration suppressed information on global warming. It's not a theory, it's a fact. So people would say, why wouldn't they lie about 9/11? Well, they did, actually. For that matter, if they would lie about 9/11, why wouldn't they conceal the truth about aliens and UFOs? And now people say, oh, there's no censorship of the media. But there is. And what occurs in the mainstream media is a kind of self-censorship. And what there are limits on what can go into the news media. It's not like the government is giving them orders telling them what to do. Although the Bush administration did try to do that but the first filter, how much time have I got left?
1 minute.
Yeah, 1 minute left. Okay, the first filter, there's the matter of ownership. The owner's gonna decide what goes in. And then there's the matter of sponsorship. The media outlets depend on ads for most of their money, so they don't want to do anything to offend their sponsors. Third is sources. Do you always go to official government sources for your information?
Yeah.
If so, you're going to repeat the government line. And then there's the matter of flack. When you get critics coming in, whether it's the White House press secretary telling the press that they ought to watch what they say, or whether it's a tank commander ordering a hit on a hotel where reporters are stationed in Baghdad. That's a pretty serious limit on the media. And then finally, there's a kind of ideology that prevails because of all of our media, either corporate-owned or corporate-sponsored, that corporations are good and socialism a la Bernie Sanders is bad. And on the subject of Bernie Sanders, election fraud does happen in America.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Any other speakers? Okay, Andy, last word.
I won. They cheated.
Well, it's very rare. Mic go off?
No, it's still on.
Is it, you hear me back there?
No.
Well.
Is it on? Here.
It may need another battery.
Censorship.
It's turned on. It is turned on, Andy.
Oh, it went dead then. That's all right. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Don't worry about that then.
All right, I'll get a new battery next week.
About 5 minutes here.
I got to run.
It's good luck. Yeah, I'd like to congratulate Don for making the point that I've been trying to make, and that point is described in one of the flyers, one of the 18 pages of this smaller printout is a one-page thing called the $1 trillion golden triangle. And that is, these are three huge databases of evidence on each one of these three subjects, scientifically unassailable, proven beyond a shadow of a doubt. All three of them are not covered by the media. And my point has been for several years, we've been following. Well, one of these subjects goes back 40 years. That's 50 years. That's the sacred myth of our military fighting for freedom and justice. The other myth is younger. That's 9/11. That's 15 years old now, this September. The other myth began in 1984 when they announced at a press conference with no proof at all, they announced that the harmless HIV virus was the cause of all the illnesses that people were dying from of AIDS. And Don made the point, he said, well, if you can ask, if they're lying to us about something like that, what else are they lying to us about? My point is, you puncture any one of these three myths, And they'll go a long way towards saying, well, if they would lie about any one of these things, what else are they lying to us about? So there's the $1 trillion triangle has a list of websites that are summaries of the large database that exists. The database on these three is like the database on asbestos or the effects of smoking 4 packs a day. You know, there's no debate on those issues anymore. Some people still smoke, but it doesn't affect everybody. But anyway, thank you, Don, for stressing that if we question, break one myth, we can start to step through the psychological barrier that Professor Griffin talked about. Step through the barrier, psychological barrier, and look at the evidence. Charlie absolutely made my point. It shows on the small part of the graph here, there are some people that can be standing in a blizzard of evidence and claim they can't see a single snowflake. And Charlie can't see the evidence that's all around us on very key issues, especially the evidence of the 39th year of Project Censor describing all the intimate details of how the press censorship functions in this country. There's no debate on that among journalists. And also, Charlie claims that editors, you know, have the assigned stories, right? Yeah. Well, that book, where is that book? This book describes how editors get fired and blackballed for trying to describe a story that they didn't know was radioactive to the owner. I highly suggest, in fact, I would take up a collection. I would pay Charlie $20 to read this book and then tell me how we don't have censorship in America. Into the Buzzsaw, leading journalists expose the myth of a free press. Christina Borgeson, and that is listed, incidentally, in it's listed in several of these places here. Dennis made the asked me if I would comment. The database on what's known about nuclear power is truly enormous. In today's world, you can say pretty much without fear of contradiction that anybody that is promoting the idea that nuclear power can help us get out of the greenhouse effect is part of a quasi-religious cult that believes, like the cult of thorium. I can speak of this. I liked Tim. You know, we're friends. I can tell Tim I was in two cults in my life. I was in the nuclear cult back in the late 70s. I thought I converted my house to all electric power for 1 year. I thought getting electricity from clean nukes was going to be better than allowing the fossil fuel industry to get and continue to run coal generators. And then I started to read stuff in 1980. That was when I read John Goffman's book, Poison Power. It came out in 1979. That was my first exposure to John Goffman, and it was an eye-opener. So basically, a nuclear power has any form of new nuclear plant will be, before we can get 1 kilowatt of energy out of a nuclear plant, the climate snowball that's moving, the inertia will be so great that you can look to Manhattan being under 20 feet of water before we get 10 nuclear plants running.
Is that such a bad thing, though?
That's the time frame that we're looking at. We have to help people step through the psychological barrier and honestly look at the evidence. Nuclear power is considered now by Wall Street analysts as the largest financial disaster in human history for any kind of industrial project. And that was published in 1985. That was the tip of the iceberg back then. Today, the whole iceberg is out there. No private investors anywhere in the world are talking about putting up their money privately for the next generation of nuclear power plants. They're hoping to get nuclear welfare from governments to finance these things. Bernie talked about, is it Bernie? No, is that Bernie?
It's Kane.
What? Are you Bernie?
No.
Gene. You're Gene. I had a scene a moment there.
Oh, sorry. I totally spaced that. That's why I don't drink alcohol. I hallucinate with the best of them periodically. Stone cold sober. Gene made the good point that, you know, the lies our teachers told us.
James Bowen.
We're told a bunch of lies growing up in school, and when we find out the history of what Columbus really did, for example, or this is what Jim Mars is talking about in his green book, our occulted history. You want to know what the real history, what unfolded over the last 300-400 years and what they've been covering up. This is one of the best single books you can read. You don't have to read 20 books on these subjects.
It's loaded.
Here
you go. Thanks.
I'll quickly address, as I said, I was part of two cults, the cult of nuclear power until I recognized it was a cult. And I was also involved briefly in the late 70s in the cult of Amway, where they teach you can become rich and famous if you work your way up the pyramid that they don't call a pyramid. They call it
multi-level
marketing. Yeah. And yeah. Amway is the greatest free enterprise, far right-wing cult that's ever been created anywhere on earth that I know of. There are some other religious cults that suck people in, and they shut themselves off from their friends and basic reality and everything else. That's a true religious cult. But the cult of Amway helps people close their minds to the actual reality of what's happening around them. And the owners, the founders of Amway are best buds with Bush and Cheney, and the right wingers that, you know, the billionaires that run this country. So, the last thing I would repeat again Professor Griffin's admonition that to understand the information on some of these subjects, you don't need an open mind and a physics degree or a biological degree. You need a 30% open mind and a willingness just to look at the evidence with common sense. It's so easy to understand. But if you can't look at the evidence, then you're still stuck in that cult-like position where you're living in a bubble. You know, we have people in this room that are incredibly knowledgeable on certain subjects, but that are in a quasi-religious cult on another subject, just ignoring reality and standing in a blizzard of evidence claiming you can't see a single snowflake. That's what you're talking about in these handouts, especially that one on the brain chemistry and everything else. That's basic human race, we all have it in our genes. We've evolved this way. We process, the brain processes information this way. It take you 2 or 3 hours to read that whole report. I'm trying to summarize it for you quickly here in a presentation tonight, but that's one of the most fascinating things I've read on how the brain processes information and how information spreads through a population until it becomes common knowledge, okay? So anybody that wants further reading, take one of each of these handouts up here. My phone number is on there from the Northwest Information Service. You can call us, you can borrow a book if you want. We have a couple hundred books on these subjects that we loan out that if you can't get them from the library, you don't want to buy your own copy. So there's a ton of information that exists in highly credible books that's not available in the mainstream news. And a lot of it, some of it is available on the internet now in reports. A lot of these authors are running websites. Like Harvey Wasserman has a site about everything nuclear, and the website Truthout has a good site with all tons of environmental information. And of course, the Rocky Mountain Institute has been publishing the economic alternatives to nuclear power, since 1980. And their whole point is maybe the thorium plants would be clean, safe, but they would be 10 times more expensive than solar and wind that's were available today. That's the economics, the raw economics we're looking at. What used to cost $1,800 for 300 watts of solar panels is $1,800 20 years ago. Today, you get 300 watts of solar for $150, not $1,800. The price has dropped from near $2,000 down to $150, and it's still creeping down there. So solar, I came by north, I went to Buckhouse Square yesterday to check it out and drop off my proposal. I might give a speech there on their annual July 30th.
and along Lord, there's a market. There's like a whole, not a Whole Foods, but there's a grocery store on Lawrence Avenue. That the whole front side of the roof of that, in east and west, is covered with solar panels, right here in the city. So the sun shines in Chicago just like it does in Germany. There's a rooftop revolution going on that can help us phase out of all coal, like Harvey Wasserman said, King Kong. Coal, oil, nukes, and gas. He
said, in Germany?
Huh?
That's in Germany?
There's a rooftop revolution. No, the market here is North Lawrence Avenue.
Which market?
There's a foreign marketplace, a food store. Okay. Food store on the north side of the street.
It's not far from the hilltop.
4,000 west. It's west of the hilltop on Lawrence Avenue. But if you look in the city, a lot of businesses are putting up solar panels for electricity because it's cheaper than ComEd's kilowatts right now.
ComEd is
positioning themselves to be like the running a toll gate. They're not going to produce electricity. They're going to charge people a toll for using their lines. And it's a revolution that's coming with ComEd and the others as we switch to solar. So there's a rooftop revolution going on in clean, safe, affordable, high efficiency energy sources and high efficiency buildings, LED lights, the houses without furnaces, 100 mile per gallon cars are coming.
They're doing that in historic Pullman too.
In other, all kinds of places. Yeah. Yeah, we got to get going.
Okay, so gavel us out, Andy.
Huh?
Gavel us out. Dismiss us.
Okay, the college is dismissed tonight.
All right. Yay. 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 See ya. All right.